Ordinary human beings, settle down. Take your seats. Stop trying to project your DNA out into space. It's not going to help. You're doomed. All right, so let me introduce the next panel. The next panel's on games. So here's an interesting phenomenon of the modern world, of our lives. When I was a kid and I came home, I had to be told to do homework. But I also had to be told to stop playing games. Why is it that you have to tell people to stop playing games and to do their homework? What if you could combine them? What if we could expand the human imagination in ways that we found fascinating and salient and playful and rigorous? And that's what this panel does. They create worlds that allow us to explore concepts outside of the confines of disciplinary dictatorship. Okay. No, I just coined that phrase. That's pretty good, right?
I like it.
Yeah. Okay. So just think about chess, right? I mean, take a game that we all know, or many of us do, and it teaches strategy and it teaches logic. It's been used in the history of the development of artificial intelligence. It teaches us combinatorics and mathematics. So this tiny, constrained micro world is full of richness. And I think more than many other people I can think of, they create micro worlds full of richness. So let me introduce them all. So in starting here on my right is Lauren Scott. Lauren is a designer. She's working across many different areas of the game industry. She studied economics and computer science at Santa Cruz. She went to work for the Evil Empire. Well, not quite, but large video game companies before actually seeing the light, and now is working for Double Fine on the sequel to The Great Psychonauts and on Psychonauts 2. And let me see where your bios are. Yeah. Who's next? Tarn Adams, right here, is the co-founder of Bay12 Games with his brother Zach. They worked on a game that is extraordinarily complicated. I have to say, I have played this game and it's just infinitely deep, called Dwarf Fortress. It's one of the first video games acquired by the Museum of Modern Art in New York. He has been writing procedural games for over 20 years and has a PhD in mathematics, where he worked on the, I think, sort of metrical embedding of vector spaces of some kind. And so that's Tarn Adams. And then we have Jonathan Blow sitting next to him. Jonathan Blow is kind of legendary indie game developer. He's developed two really beautiful games. One that experiments with a theme that will come up tomorrow, which is time, the hour of time and time travel, Braid, beautiful game. And most recently, the game The Witness, that combines sort of abstract puzzle world with an island world, and somehow solving these puzzles means conjoining these realities. And overseeing this panel is the great, magnificent, where's your bio, man? somebody we all know. Frank Lantz. And Frank is the director. He's actually spent some time at SFI this year, we're delighted, writing his book. He's the director of the NYU Game Center. He's taught game design for over 12 years at NYU. But he's also, he co-founded in 2005 a game company which developed a game that some of you might know called Drop 7. It's a beautifully creative game. So take it away, game panel.
Thank you very much. So we have kind of on the panel a wide range of game designers who operate in a bunch of different modes. Lauren, you work on big games. You've worked on very large, big budget, AAA titles on giant teams, being a game designer within a much bigger process. Yep. Tarn, you are someone who works outside of the industry as a kind of lone wolf for years, developing this very eccentric, idiosyncratic, very personal game, Dwarf Fortress, that's gone on to be incredibly influential and important, but you work in isolation. And then, John, you work in small teams. So you're kind of an independent artist, but you also gather people and have this kind of medium-sized team that you work on your projects for. So I'd like to start out by just getting each of you to talk a little bit about what your daily life is like as a game designer. What's your process like? What's your day-to-day like as you do game design? Just to give people a sense of what it means to be a game designer. So maybe we'll start with Lauren and then just work our way down. Just what's your process like,
sure,
on a day-to-day basis?
So I work at a relatively large, medium-sized indie studio called Double Fine. So I work with a group of artists, producers, writers, programmers, and a team of designers. So my day usually looks like when I come in, you know, I walk in, sit down at my desk, download the latest version of the game, which doesn't take too long, but long enough to like go get a snack from the kitchen or something. I sit back down, look at my notebook for like the things I was doing yesterday, basically, to remind myself like what I need to do. And then throughout the day, I'm working on maybe like a main task or a main thing. And throughout the day, you know, like other like programmers, other designers, artists will come to my desk and just kind of flow in and out with questions or requests. I'll go to meetings where we discuss like design topics, design like make decisions for the game like as a group. And then by the end of the day, hopefully I have that main thing done.
Yeah, I as the introduction said, I just work on the game with my brother Zach, and I get up in the morning and we just go out to coffee, and there's always some problem to work on. It might not be the problem that I'm going to be. I also do the programming, so it might not be the problem that I'm going to be coding on that day. But we just hash out like what we think the sticking points are, what we think the path that we should take for some future day's work, and then I just go home and sit in front of the computer all day pretty much without interacting with other people about it, just thinking through problems. It reminds me a lot of math, actually, the way that we would kind of talk to, say, your advisor or something, and then just go sit down and think about a problem, not get anywhere on it, and then wake up the following morning and understand what was wrong. It's really quite similar.
Our company is medium size.
Mm-hmm. It's on.
Says it's on.
Okay. Great. Bring on the handheld.
Okay. Yeah, so as you mentioned, my company is sort of a medium size, mm-hmm. like about 14 people right now. But when we were building it up, I was very careful and clear to myself that I'm not going to be one of these people who becomes like a manager and doesn't do real game stuff anymore or whatever, mm-hmm. right? And so as a result of that, I wear many hats and don't have a very typical day-to-day because I still program, I design, I do business deals, I try to help decide, you know, if we're hiring somebody or whatever, right? And, you know, games being what it is, one of those is usually urgent at any given time, at least one. And so that's what I'll be working on at the given day. Like, I'm sort of the bottleneck between everything. Like, there's always people who can't do their work until I decide something or make something go further. And so whatever I feel the most guilty about, I work on that. And then...
It sounds like a director of a film in your case. You're doing a lot of different things.
Yeah,
depending
I have no
experience
with films.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Do you think there does it make sense to talk about game design as a well-defined discipline, or is it just a very loose collection of different kinds of approaches that just is a catch-all phrase for the process of creative game development?
I mean, there are a lot of people doing work attempting to formalize it, but then there are a lot of studios who are kind of just throwing shit at the wall and seeing what sticks, and yeah. that works sometimes.
I mean, I think there's just different purposes, right?
And how so?
Well, there's some games that are just very clearly commercial products, right? That's the whole point. And they're incidentally games, right? And then there's some other games that are, you know, we're designers trying to work as hard as we can to make something interesting that is a game design, right? Mm-hmm. And then there's things in between that as well. And I don't mean to draw one dimension. There's probably other dimensions. And so designing the commercial product is so different from designing the interesting, like, product of game design research that I can't say that I feel like they have much in common.
Really, when you think about making a commercial product, you think about making something that's going to be popular, and things that are popular are things that hang together and touch people and entertain them. And so, aren't these things kind of like Or do you feel like the commercial context is a constraint? Well, that's, okay, you're always okay. working against it. What do you think?
That the commercial process is a differential process. It's a start with something that we know that works, and then find a small delta from that to something nearby that also will work and hopefully will be better, right? Whereas, you know, what something like Dwarf Fortress or something like what I do is not like that at all. It's like we're just somewhere lost in space and trying to build something coherent. It's very different.
Yeah, I mean, I guess we could use like these kind of like I've been to a few events where a psychologist will come and talk about how to kind of optimize your loot box buttons and so forth in kind of the most nefarious way possible in order to maximize player engagement and also spending and so forth. And arguably, that's a game design discipline, and there are things that we could use in that in a completely different way, because the concepts, to the extent they're accurate, are universal-ish or whatever. And at the same time, I mean, I haven't found myself going down a lot of those rabbit holes. It's hard to, I mean, it's just like learning anything. It's hard to know which directions you should go, and then when you have more experience, you just start developing some intuition. But then when you go back and look at what, you know, some book, I don't know, A Theory of Fun or something like that, maybe it'll resonate in one way or another, and you'll learn something that you'd already been doing, but you can put words to it now or something, and then you realize, well, yeah, game design is a thing.
Mm-hmm. I've often felt that a good game designer should understand slot machines, right? You should know how a slot machine works.
Uh-oh. Nobody understands slot machines. Seriously.
Really?
Yeah, nobody does.
You don't know what it means if we're in a design meeting and I say, ooh, this could use just a little bit of a slot machine. Don't you think that's a thing that a game designer should, like, intuitively or...
Like, intimately, or...?
No, just enough to understand what I'm saying. If I say, Tarn, this could use a little more slot machine, right? You would know how to, like,
well, it depends.
Interpret that.
If you were that psychologist, it would mean one thing. And if you were, you know, Frank, it would mean something else, probably. But, I mean, I generally get the sense, maybe, of what you mean.
Like, Diablo, you know, the way weapons work in Diablo. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right, that's a slot machine. What do you mean that people don't understand what a slot machine is? Isn't it a simple? It's a simple device. It's the simplest.
Why do they work?
No theories about why they work?
Well, I mean...
I have theories.
Let's not bore people. I mean, we have theories, but they're not...
Because the brain is a machine that's designed to predict and... It gets some kind of like reinforcement, loop of sensing and predicting, and this a machine that plugs into that and rides it like a parasite.
Diablo is a little different because it can take like player stats and player history and then spit out something based on that data, whereas like slot machines don't know who's sitting in front of it and who has been sitting in front of it for 10 minutes versus like 3 hours. So
maybe they do now. I don't know.
Oh no, they have little cameras.
Anyway, so the thing that you said there, Frank, makes sense. We could go digging down into the details and make it sound even more plausible. It's exactly the kind of thing that 30 years later people go look back on and say, oh, that's what they thought. I could see how they fooled themselves into thinking that.
Well, there's another definition of understanding something is you understand something when you can build it. I'm pretty sure I can build a slot machine in JavaScript. That'll work. I mean, some people
you can build a slot machine. You cannot build the slot machine, the system of the slot machine and the player playing it.
That's true.
Let's bring this back.
Okay, let's bring it back. So a lot of the ways you all have talked about your work is in terms of problem solving. And I'm curious about the place that game design occupies in between the kind of problem solving that engineers do, where you're fixing something, if something's broken, or you're trying to understand how to make something work, and there's a kind of objective quality to like the problem and the solution, and the problem solving that a designer does or an artist does, which we think of as being more intuitive, free-flowing, exploratory. How do you guys think about how your process fits somewhere in that spectrum.
I'm always going first. I guess usually, like, most of the time if I have a feature or something that I'm working on, it starts with what I want the player to experience, obviously. And I start from that, and then I usually form a hypothesis or two about what they want, about what would satisfy that. And then I start working, scripting, Unreal stuff, whatever. And then...
Can you give us an example? What's an example?
An example?
Yeah.
I guess on... So in Mafia 3, I had to work on this complex narrative system called sit-downs, and it linked into like all the different hideouts and districts that you could like get as a mafia boss. Like, you'd go through a hideout, and then you'd have to assign it to a lieutenant, and then at a sit-down, you'd have to decide who to give that district to like permanently, and then that would like make other bosses mad, and eventually sometimes they would actually retaliate against you and you'd have to go kill them or whatever. But so that was like actually this huge, just complex, like pulling data from every like corner of the game. There, it wasn't just the districts, it was like all these other things that kind of just wove through the entire game. So that was a big one. And for that one, we kind of just had to slice it into disparate pieces, like the district loop, the like spoke loop, like the lieutenant, their like special quests and things like that to make them like more manageable, mm-hmm. and then figure out how to make those specific pieces fun. And so I work on something until I hit a sticking point, as you always will as a designer, and then I'll talk to the person who I think is most likely to have the answer, like another designer, lead. Sometimes it's an artist, or if I don't know, then I'll ask a producer and they'll find the person for me and just kind of keep going like that.
Yeah, so for me, I mostly do simulations in my game. So it's something that essentially runs without the player really needing to do anything for stretches of time, and you can just kind of watch the game unfold. In my case, that would be a bunch of dwarves running around, you know, getting drunk and making things and getting in fistfights and stuff. And I mean, it's not unlike The Sims, which you guys may have heard of. And so when I add something new to the game, I mean, I definitely get this dichotomy, right, between engineering and then designing. Because when I'm thinking about adding something new to the simulation, I have to figure out, how can I make this work at all? Like, if I want to do water pressure or something where the water goes down and then up the other side of the pipe, how do I even do that, right? And that's a purely technical problem at first. And then there's the other side of it, where this is a game and everything you do relates to the player in some way, and you need to think about the player's experience of that. You know, are they going to understand what's going on? How can they see that the water is there? And do you want to help them not drown or just, you know, let it ride? These are all decisions you have to make. Every single decision, the ones that you don't think of, are still going to come back and haunt you for years. So you have to, like, switch hats quite a bit. I've kind of, like, end up on the engineering side of it a lot, because I also program the game, so I don't really know what it's like to not have the control to kind of come in and fix the things literally. And everyone's got different experiences with exactly how the process works, but I definitely feel that kind of feedback loop between player experience, which is a whole field that, you know, has people that are dedicated to that side of the job, and then all the way back to the purely technical side, where you pretend it's not even a game at all. So.
I tend to work on games that are complex, in maybe not in the technical sense, but there's a lot of dimensions of what I'm concerned with at any given time, and I'm definitely trying to optimize for those concerns. Like, and I can write on a piece of paper, you know, here are the things that I'm trying to do. You know, I'm trying to I should have thought of an example while they were talking. But I'm trying to do this, trying to do that, trying to do that. But those statements will not really be complete statements because the things, each, any one of those items is nuanced enough, what I'm trying to do, that like really the, only the subconscious really understands it. So you can't like linearly logicalize any one of them, and then they all push on each other. So to the extent that I try to make number three happen, it fights against number two a little bit, and that makes me unhappy, and that makes me doubt my design in the beginning a little bit, but then, you know,
and
that's...
And number two and number three in this model are both creative goals?
Yes.
Okay, so they're like two conflicting creative goals.
Well, hopefully, initially they were not intended to conflict,
right.
And then you, as you explore them, you maybe find some ways that they conflict. Also, I will say I push on that a lot harder than most other designers, because... I tend to do what we would think of today as a little bit of an Eastern aesthetic, where there's like a right making of things and everything is like maximally positioned with respect to everything else, you know? And so there's when everything is interconnected like that, as much as you can humanly make it, then you have a maximum number of problems.
Yeah.
Because anything that you change ruins five other things, right? Going back to your original question, I am definitely trying to do that kind of an optimization, but it relies very, very much on deep judgment calls that I don't completely understand with my conscious mind. Hmm. There's this. It's funny. There's a stereotype of a wacky artist who comes in one day and says, "We have to do this decision because this is what makes the game right." And then the weekend goes by and they come in Monday and they say, "We have to do this other thing instead," and they're equally passionate about it, right? And it sort of gives a stereotype of like, oh, artsy people are wacky and don't really know what they're doing, unlike engineers. Actually, there's two different things going on. One is some of those people really are wacky and don't know what they're doing. But for some of those people, they're working in this very constrained space where there's like rubber bands between all these things. And if the design were ideal, you know, this thing, the first choice, would have been the right one. And we're pushing on that for a while. But it's like not working. And this other thing wasn't working as well. And then we saw something new about some other thing. Mm. And that like shifts the ideal point mm-hmm. of this thing that's tied with rubber bands to everything else. And it changes the ideal decision to something that maybe we had said before was not the right decision. Right. Mm-hmm. And so... design for me is just a constant process of that for years. And then I'm sad about the result because it's never perfect.
Right. But it's not a steady step-by-step progress. It's more of this kind of elliptical. Is that true for all of you, that you find that you need to kind of have this open-ended exploration and a thing you thought was going to be important ends up not being as important as you thought?
Yeah, I mean, I think during the process of creating a game or anything creative, you come to a point where you just think it's like absolute shit or close to it, and for various reasons, and you just kind of have to like push through that.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of like, you know, listing design goals, I mean, for us, one of the two things playing against each other the most are dwarves should have rich inner lives and be able to do what they want, you know, so that they express themselves as characters and have narrative arcs and so forth. And at the same time, the player should be able to play the game and direct what happens. And those things really are completely opposed to each other. And there's no rules there. You make wrong decisions all the time. I have so many features that have been reduced, cut, changed, because it felt like we had we were nudging the dwarves just enough, but then they felt like, oh no, now they're not doing what we think they should be doing based on, you know, their own internal personalities and so forth. And it's almost inscrutable too, because the big problem is that you don't know how your players are receiving things. Ever really, unless, I mean, you can kind of get an idea after the fact, but that's a bit late. And it's you know, all intuition and just trying your best after experiencing it for a long time.
Also, if you're on a larger team, you might start with a design and other people come in with their ideas and their input, and that's another way design can morph and change, and it kind of depends on whether you just want to be like authoritative and put your foot down and be like, no, this is my design, this is like, I'll take your feedback, but ultimately it's going to stay the same thing it was foundationally, or it's more like this at my current studio where like everybody's creative input is valued, and so, but that means that when you take stuff in, it fundamentally sometimes changes the design, and then you have to figure out how that design works and then how that propagates to everything else in the game. So, yeah.
I would love to hear each of you talk a little bit about some of your inspirations. What do you look to in the world of games or even outside of games as touchstones for the kind of work that you want to do, as influences or inspiration? Did anything come to mind?
I can go back this time. I really like playing games that I wouldn't normally like hear a lot about, like stuff that's kind of, because I know I'll eventually get to Apex Legends or League or whatever. But one of the ways that I do that is in San Francisco, we have this little community, and we do this thing called Game of the Fortnight, where every fortnight, every 2 weeks, we vote on one new like indie game to play.
Okay.
And it's either something that like just came out or something that someone found in a corner somewhere, and we vote on it, and then we have 2 weeks to play it, and then we come together as a group, and everyone else are game developers too, so we come together and then we discuss it critically, and like that's been amazing to just like every 2 weeks you're playing a new game. Yeah. That's, I don't know, whatever.
So Fortnite. Fortnite is the game that you find.
No!
Right. Have people heard of this?
Were here before Fortnite.
Okay. So it's not the game Fortnite,
no,
it's just
we
the concept of 2 weeks.
We'll never touch.
Okay.
N-I-G-H-T.
Have you come across anything that's meant a lot to you, that you encountered?
Meant a lot.
That people might not have heard of, or that you'd like to...
I think the most recent game we played was Wandersong, and it's about this bard that, like, saves the world by singing. And, like, that the main mechanic is singing and not, like, shooting or jumping or whatever. I just thought was, like, really interesting and cool. And it's, like, sometimes the gameplay doesn't totally, like, it's not, like, a... You know, it doesn't change my world or whatever, but just the fact that someone was willing to go down and explore that one thing that's different than everything else.
I do like also the fact that you, when talking about your inspiration, you talk about a community, right? Mm-hmm. And I often, when people come to me and say, well, I'm not into games, what game should I play? My advice is often, find out what your friends are playing and play that. Play a game with some other people and then talk to them about it and try to like understand what they, and that to me is more important than that they go play, you know, Her Story or The Witness or, you know, Cinco Paus or some, you know, masterpiece. It's like, find a group of people and play with them. That's great advice, I think. Mm-hmm. Tarn, now, did anything come to mind, inspirations, influences?
I mean, I'm an ancient critter, been doing the same thing for so long that my inspirations are all buried in the old dust pretty much. When it comes to like why I'm doing what I'm doing. So old things like Starflight and the old roguelike games, things like that. But now Dwarf Fortress still changes a lot based on the things that I'm exposed to. And I find that's really not games at all, but really just like really bad reality shows and stuff. Like I Was Bitten is a reality show about people have been bitten by animals.
Oh yeah.
I've seen like, there's like 4 episodes or something. I don't know. There's not that many. It includes an elephant bite, which was horrifying.
The
elephant bit somebody and squeezed them and then their guts shot out.
Oh.
We don't think too, it is trashy television. I mean, it really is.
But it also sounds like something that would happen in Dwarf Fortress.
Exactly. Elephants are terrifying in Dwarf Fortress. Yeah. But the thing that reminded me of that one in particular is when you get a rattlesnake bite, it swells up, and just the swelling itself causes something called compartment syndrome, which they kindly explained in the show, which the swelling pinches off the blood vessels, and then that causes further damage down the line because the blood's not being delivered. And so what they do is called a fasciotomy, where they relieve the pressure. They just cut the skin with a scalpel. And So we added compartment syndrome and fasciotomy to Dwarf Fortress.
Oh my God.
And it detects like the swelling variable and then whether or not there are wounds of certain types on the dwarves. And so, and this is like an example of bad game design because the players don't care, right? I mean, it reminds me, I think it was a Sid Meier thing that like a game is either designed for the designer, for the player, or for the computer. And Dwarf Fortress is really dipping into all three pretty heavily. There's stuff that we just love to do. There's stuff the players actually like. And then there's the stuff that's just burning the CPU and could be done better. So,
John, any inspirations or influences?
Most of my influences are things that people aren't going to know what they were because they're from 30 years ago.
Like what?
Like when I was a kid. Brian Moriarty's text adventure Trinity from 1980. Six or whatever year that
Do
was.
People know who Brian Moriarty is?
No, they don't.
Trinity? What else?
Okay,
is Loom? Is that Brian Moriarty?
I didn't play Loom when it came out.
Yeah.
What else? There's a game called NetTrek that I played a lot in college.
NetTrek.
Do you know
yeah.
that one?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I was good at that game for a while. Counter-Strike after that, original Counter-Strike. So you can see how my games today are influenced by those games.
Tarn, you mentioned this idea of bad game design, which is a topic that I am fascinated by. And I sometimes get into trouble because I love bad design. And I think great games are often examples of what sophisticated, well-trained game designer might identify as bad design. And yet often, they're the thing that produces truly great experiences. Yeah, I don't know. Am I off base here, or am I right? Do the other two of you also recognize sometimes when you find yourself doing a thing where it's like, yeah, this isn't technically good design. Like, this isn't smooth design. It's not efficient. But somehow it's necessary, right? And it's gonna go in the game regardless.
I mean, a lot of times at Double Fine, when we're in meetings or when we're just like at our desk talking about if something should go in the game, the highest criteria is whether it's funny or not.
Yeah.
And that just like trumps everything else. And like we have these like chattering teeth in the game that we had to spend time on, and they're there, and they don't really do. I mean, they're just like flavor, and we could have allocated that time to something else. There are also some one-off things in the game where like we could have taken this and used it and copy-pasted it to like other places in the game to make it a mechanic that's seen a few times and the player learns and then, you know, but we kind of just use it like once as a gag to maximize its like joke potential or whatever. So I don't know if that's bad game design, but it's, yeah. Just depends on what your goal is maybe. I don't know.
Now, John, I think you have a reputation of being a very careful, very deliberate designer,
yeah.
But are there examples in your own work where you would say...
I mean, I do things all the time that, like, somebody who learned game design in school would think is bad game design, but I disagree with them about that, right? So, like, all the time that I know are less fun, that I know players aren't really going to understand, that they may think is broken. I all the time art direct artists to make something look less good, because making it look more good impacts the game in other ways. Like it draws player attention, for example. I haven't ever done a game where I didn't make those kind of decisions.
Yeah.
And so I don't very much respect the classical idea of good game design. Let me put that way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I understand what you mean. So I want to find a way to maybe tie some of the things that we do as game designers to the larger themes of the festival, which have to do with complexity science, so what SFI does. And one of the things that they do at the Institute is look at the world in terms of systems. When you have a collection of elements that are organized by some rules, and then you end up having surprising, interesting behavior that's hard to predict, as game designers, we wrestle with systems. I think, Lauren, in your case, your title is systems designer. So I want to hear from each of you how you think about your work in terms of systems. Like, and do you have conceptual tools or methods for kind of wrangling with systems in your design. Did anyone want to take a crack at that?
I think of it in terms of player experience, like I said, but also in terms of scalability for the team and just like creating something that is like solid for like throughout the rest of production. I had to create a system for like interactive objects in our game, like that are placed everywhere. I had to, you know, create a set of base classes that could then be basically made into like this huge library of objects. So in making a system like that, you have to think about, okay, how should this feel for the player? How should it be? But then also, how should it be architected so that it's easy for designers to use and place, easy for artists to art up, and like easy for programmers to extend. So it's like a lot of different dimensions.
Yeah, I mean that the issue of extensibility is big for us because the game has been going on forever. So if I add a new system to the game, I need to be able to revisit it years later sometimes and then just glue a new piece to it. But at the same time, it can't feel incomplete without those pieces. It still needs to fit in nicely to the rest of the game. There's also the way we think about systems a lot in Dwarf Fortress is also in terms of emergent narrative, which is our kind of central focus, which is the player being able to play the game and then extract a story from it rather than having the game tell a story. And so all of our systems, ideally, are narrative focused. And that what that means is something I'm still kind of grappling with. When you think of the player's story that they're constructing in their mind is pretty much a linear thing, and the next piece of the game they hit has to connect to other sort of narratively interesting systems in the game. And what those are sometimes is quite surprising. For me, it was engraving statues ending up being one of the most important narrative systems in Dwarf Fortress, just because people like to cap their stories with a dwarf carving a statue, and then whatever that dwarf makes, which is essentially a random image, which it'll describe to you, will then be interpreted by the player richly as this, you know, this is what my fortress was about, this is what the dwarves were thinking when the fortress was finally falling and I had a dwarf run over to a wall and carve something. It's really a kind of a great ending to a story oftentimes. And caught me a little off guard. I mean, we put those in there for different reasons. We put them in as decoration because people like to make things look nice, and then they ended up being sort of a central system of the game, which we then, you know, added more features to kind of enhance the potential that was discovered after the fact.
Cool. Like exploration of systems, which is not quite the right phrase. I don't know what the right phrase for it, but something like that is one of the chief avenues by which games can be mind-expanding. And 50 years when we look back and have more of an understanding of games as a medium and what they can do that's different from other media, then the systemic aspect will be one of those chief things that like films can't do and that novels can't do as well. And that actually, one of the reasons I'm so convinced of that is that we already have insight into multiple different avenues or flavors of that same thing, right? So there are dynamical systems, which is something like you're playing a game with a lot of different atomic interactions that you're supposed to be learning, a game like Spelunky, right? And then you go set off some trap somewhere and something complicated happens and you die, but you like saw all the steps of it, you saw the setup and you should have known, right? And then you got killed and it was kind of funny. Why was it kind of funny? Because you should have, there's actually a lot more to say about that. And then there are pre-authored systems, more like I've been doing for the past couple of days, or couple of games, sorry, past decade, where it was my job beforehand to go explore a system and then essentially build an interactive illustration of that system, right? And so the player is exploring a system that is, it's more like a fossil of a system almost, than a living system, but equally valuable, I think. And those are distinct, and they're both enabled by interactivity. So if you ever went to Smarty Pants game design conferences, you know, in the 90s and 2000s, everyone would always put on their Smarty hat and say, what makes games different from other media is interactivity. And that's just a very incomplete answer, because, like, what does that mean? What does the interactivity do? And enabling you to explore and understand a system to a degree to which human beings never have been able to in prior human history is one thing that we can do with interactivity. And we haven't even found the other ones, which is why games has so much potential, right? Huh. And so people spend half their lives, like if somebody wants to become an expert economist, right? He's gonna read lots of books about economics. He doesn't really get to design an economic system and see it happen until now, right? Yeah. And so we've had this educational system where you have to read these linear strings of words and build intuition by reading many times and many different versions of it and having many conversations. But with games, we can go straight to the intuition, which is not a complete replacement for that kind of education because you still need the facts and the numbers, but it's a much stronger, like, undercoding for that sort of thing. And I think we've only begun to explore the potential of that.
There is this possibly optimistic idea of systems literacy, right? That is perhaps growing, a new kind of literacy that allows people to see the world in its complexity as interacting parts and rules. And there's this idea that I think SFI and this festival is kind of promoting, which is that we can all increase our systems literacy. And maybe games are one avenue towards that. That in playing games, players start to develop the kinds of conceptual skills that then they might apply to understanding real-world problems like climate change or inequality or economic growth or healthcare. Do you think that that's possible that could happen? I mean, one way to think about this, David Krakauer talks about cognitive artifacts, and some of them augment our ability to think and improve our ability to think, and some of them replace our cognitive skills and in some ways diminish our ability. Which are games, in your view? Should we be optimistic about the capacity to increase systems literacy? What do you think?
Okay, there's two kinds of systems literacy. Or two ways in which games can be applied to this, right? There's one is easier and one is harder. The easier one is understanding a specific system by building a lower resolution version of that system. For example, if I want to understand economics, I can make an economics simulator game, and it's not as nuanced as the real world and whatever. And because of that, I should be very wary of the conclusions that I draw from watching the thing. And I'm doubtful that we will ever get to a place where you make an economics game and can draw the right policy decisions from it, because it's not the real world. And the real world being a complex system, as it is, if you pare back one or two levels of if you turn a fractal into a non-fractal, you lose a lot, right? Okay, so that's one. And then the other one is general understanding of systems. Like, if you play a bunch of shooters and you play a bunch of 4X games, do you understand economic simulators better? Never having played
one. In a general sense, yeah.
And I claim yes. That's harder, though, and we're not as good at... We haven't even tried to produce that very effectively yet, but I believe that I see it already happening.
Okay, so you think there's reason to be optimistic? What do you guys think?
I mean, I think on that same note, there's the risk of giving people who play games like a false sense of knowing more than they do about certain things. Like, there was this whole YouTube thing that just happened like during E3 about Modern Warfare or whatever. This guy, like, you know, saying mean stuff about the designers because they weren't, you know, committing to making it real enough so that players could really understand how war is, like, and like that's what Modern Warfare should do for the player. And it's like, you know, that there's the risk of that, you know, players just thinking, oh, now I know about war or mm-hmm. economics or whatever, just by playing like a game. So mm-hmm. there's that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it doesn't have to be perfect is one optimistic thing to say, I suppose. Right. Like in the economics case, like I was writing a simulation of the economy, and it became very clear why loans and insurance exist, for instance, right? And we maybe hear, you know, oh, you can share risk, right? Or you can, you know, liquidity is important for whatever reason. But if you get your hands on that and your own economic empire or whatever is stopped for not nuanced reasons, but for simple reasons for which we have solutions, then you can come to understand things that we already know. But that's a lot of what education is, and becoming literate is right. understanding things that a lot of people understand.
It does make me think that maybe if there is this development of a new kind of literacy, systems literacy, maybe it's wrong to look for examples of it in this microscale of things happening this year, last year. And you're talking about this, like, what is risk? How do we share risk as a society? And how do things like insurance and loans operate? And maybe, in a sense, like, games are contributing to that understanding by, you know, over the past 200 years, right? By giving us examples like toy models of risk that we can play with. So it's this maybe this slow glacial process of developing literacy. I don't know.
We could speed it up way a lot.
You think we should
yeah.
pick up the pace?
Oh, yeah.
You know? Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I agree with that.
I want to hear a little bit about your relationship to technology. Are we?
We're done. Yeah. Q&A now.
Q&A?
Oh.
Okay. Okay, so maybe I'll just float that as a potential topic for questions, because one of the things we haven't talked about is maybe some of the things that people assume we would talk about. Like, we didn't talk about virtual reality, right? And you know what I mean? Like, that's a thing that people are excited about to hear in contemporary games. But I will just stop it there, and thank you very much, and now open it up to see if we can hear from the audience. So thanks very much to the panel, and let's see if we have any questions.
Yeah.
Hi.
About technology or anything.
Okay, so I was reading an article recently, and Jonathan, you were mentioned in it, and you talked about games being a different medium from movies, music, and all those things. And so what I was wondering was, you talked about people trying to tell stories in games and those things, and how really they're not exploring some of the neater things that they can do with games, and with it being interactive, and what you were just talking about recently. So when you're coming up with game mechanics, how do you come up with those? Do you start with a story, or do you go about it elsewhere? How do you do that?
No, I am... So whatever I say is not my claim that it's the right answer, right? It's my style. My style is... I don't actually know what it is. I mean, I just have some idea that I'm very excited about. And these days, those ideas tend to be about a fundamental interactive thing or just a moment that you have in your mind. When I was much earlier in my career, I would have ideas about like setting or whatever. But as you do more design and just practice a lot, your brain gets trained at what kind of things actually make good games and what don't. And so I just have worked on games for a long time and have better ideas. But yeah, I don't start with story because I would write books or make films if I thought I wanted to do story.
Yeah, I mean, I only have a little bit to add there. I mean, our way of coming up with which systems to use to generate stories, we actually start with little stories and then deconstruct them into their component pieces and think about why, you know, this sentence had this thing going on that we can actually put in the game that caused the story to really drive through that entire paragraph, and trying to figure out what it is about stories that translates into systems and then can turn into a, you know, just a giant spray of stories in all directions. That's kind of not the central way we work, but it's an important component of it.
Yeah, I mean, I guess At Double Fine, it's a very narrative-focused studio, so like on that team, that's often where we start. For my personal work, I like to more focus on smaller things, just like kind of having an idea and grinding it down to like just as distilled of a thing as possible. Like, how would I represent grief, like the abstract idea of grief? How would I, like, or taking just some small mechanic that I think is fun and just trying to like squeeze as much out of it as possible. So,
question here?
Yes.
So I'd like to hear the answer to Frank's question. I'd like to know about your relationship to technology, to VR in particular. I think that was a very astute question from a really astute panel leader. And I guess I'll plug in my own extra part to that. Like, have you ever found yourself presented with a piece of technology, a sort of technological medium, and maybe VR is one of them, I don't even know if it is a medium, but when you were presented with that, you went, oh, now my brain is filling with ideas, and these are the ideas that I want to do because I have this playpen in which to play.
Yeah, VR is like that. I don't do anything in VR right now, but I think I have many ideas of what I would do if I were to. I think VR is very misunderstood, again, like most things. A lot of people think that the benefit of VR is that it's immersive or somehow that you get this 3D effect. The 3D effect I don't think matters that much. And for immersiveness, I'm very immersed when I read a book or watch a film. VR is actually less immersive because you have a heavy thing on your head that moves around and falls off and whatever, right? The great benefit of VR is that it tremendously expands the bandwidth for communication from the player to the game. Right now we have games that are talking at you all the time. There's a screen full of pixels changing 60 times a second, and there's all this audio, and you have like a button and a couple of analog axes, and that's not very much. So as soon as you have VR, you can like move the camera around in 6 degrees of freedom very effortlessly. And yeah, that maps to the human structure a little bit, but really what's happening is you just have more communication with the game. So this like 18 degrees of freedom plus buttons and stuff is way more than we've ever had. And again, I don't think game designers are doing a good job of exploring that.
Like stealthily, it is this incredibly opened up dimensionality of interaction that is sneakily what is most exciting about VR. I totally agree. Yeah,
I mean, for me, you know, my game might as well have been written technologically in like 1975 or something, right? So I don't keep up even really with a lot of that. But to me, there are still sort of digital technologies, things like the various, you know, whatever AI, that kind of thing, that are really exciting to me. And it's all still in its infancy. Things like conversations, like just modeling them. We have chat bots and other things now, but we're nowhere yet, pretty much. The machine learning stuff is kind of interesting to me, but those like paragraphs of completed text and so forth, they're fun, but I don't find them as applicable to games directly, although games like Caves of Cud have done a lot of really cool stuff with that kind of thing, Markov chains and that kind of stuff, to sort of just make books right in the game that are mostly gibberish, but it's still funny, and that's, as we say, that's what you stick with a lot of times.
Yeah, I kind of tend to stay away from VR as it exists right now. It kind of feels a bit ham-fisted the way that it's like being developed. I kind of see like these huge VR brick things that you put on your head as like kind of the missing link between phones and then the next ubiquitous thing after phones. And phones, computers, whatever, screens. And I think we have so much to still explore here, as Jonathan was saying. Like, there's just so much still to do there that I'm, like, totally happy with just drilling down with what we already have. And I have ideas for what could come after, but I don't find myself necessarily super interested in this weird, awkward, like, thing that's happening right now.
Do we have time for another question?
Oh.
We're done? Well, thank you very much. Thanks to the panel, and thanks to the audience, and enjoy the rest of the festival.
Yay. Great.
All right.